Would you take a moment and welcome somebody who's near you this morning? Walk around, it's a little spread out today. Try to introduce yourself to somebody you haven't met yet. Father, we can pray that we will never stop praising you because we know that you are faithful to never stop loving us and to never leave us or forsake us. Even in difficult situations, Lord, our hope is in you. Our hope is in heaven and in a place that you've prepared for those who love you and who recognize your Son as the Savior for our sins, God. So thank you for promising to never, ever let us go. Be with us today as we gather in your name and as we pour out our hearts and our praises to you and our prayers. We thank you, God.
though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near. And I will fear no evil, for my
promise, because your word says so. We know that times when we walk away from you, and we often do, for that we repent. But when we walk away, you're right there waiting for us, ready to embrace us again. Thank you. For the people in this room that need to be embraced by your Holy Spirit this morning, may they feel your presence. We want to worship you as we sing together, as we pray together, as we open your word, as we give an offering, as we fellowship, and as we do a baptism. Dear God, shower this place with your Holy Spirit to teach us how to worship, to serve you, to honor you, and to give you glory. We pray and ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Now grace and mercy and peace be unto us from God our Father and his Son, Jesus Christ. All of this through the operation of the Holy Spirit, and all God's people said. Thank you. Please be seated. Stephanie, Brandon, would you come forward?
And we do invite Brandon and Stephanie to come forward this morning. They are acknowledging and celebrating that God has blessed their family with a daughter, Ella Ann. And so this morning, they answer questions that they have already listened to and considered before the elders of the church. And so Stephanie and Brandon, in advance, congratulations. You are surrounded this morning by the gift of family, by the gift of friends, and by the gift of your church. And we promise that we're going to walk alongside of you and support you and love beautiful Ella as well. So the very first question I ask, do you both reaffirm your faith in Jesus Christ, confessing, acknowledging, celebrating that he is both your Savior and your Lord? Brandon and Stephanie, do you believe that? Thank you. That's what you believe regarding yourselves. But now I ask, do you also believe that little Ella Ann was conceived and born in sin, and she's under the judgment of God? That's the worst thing you could ever hear. But do you also believe that God's story, God's truth, God's word that points to Jesus is a story that includes her life as well? Do you believe that God knows Ella by name? Brandon and Stephanie, do you? Thank you. That's again what you believe. And so now we ask, what will you do? Will you use all the strength and the power that God gives you and the blessing of his Holy Spirit to tell and to show Ella Ann that she is created by God, that she can only be forgiven of her sins through Christ, and that the power of the Holy Spirit can be hers? Will you pray with her and for her and teach her how to pray? And will you use this storybook Bible to read her the truth of God every opportunity you have? Will you train her up well in the name of the Lord? Stephanie and Brandon, with the help that God alone can give you, will you do those things for her? Thank you. Pastor Mike is going to take Ella for a walk.
Good morning. They said she just woke up. That's good. Ella, look, all these people. In a minute, they'll stand for you. We'd like to do the names, and Ella means one who is beautiful. I think that's already fulfilled. And Ann means one who is understanding. Ella Ann, we pray that you will not only be beautiful on the outside, but also on the inside, and that you will have an understanding of God's word and bring God's word and understanding to others. Family and church, would you stand, please? Parents don't just be, they aren't just the ones that do the raising. I pray that if Ella stays here, some of you will be her Sunday school teacher, her youth group leader. She will see you in the narthex in doing life together. So I ask you, will you pray for her? Teach her how to pray when you're able to, and train her by your example. If you will, please say, we will. Thank you.
And Brandon and Stephanie, I'll have you present her for baptism. Ella Ann Walton, I baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of God's Holy Spirit. God bless you. Amen. And we're going to circle together in a word of prayer and celebrate this moment together. Congregation, please join us in prayer. Heavenly Father, we are encircled around a baptismal font, and we stand upon your promises and your covenant and your love for us. Thank you for Brandon and Stephanie, that you would bless them to be married to one another. Father, thank you for your love revealed in the gift of a daughter, that they may train her up in the way that she should go, that at just the right time, one day, she will stand and believe and receive Jesus as her Lord and Savior too. Until then, keep her safe and watch over her always. We pray it in Jesus' name, and all God's people say, amen. Amen. Would you go ahead and thank God for the gift of Ella's life? And as the Waltons are seated, they will be at the center door in the back following our worship this morning. Please encourage them and remind them that you are going to pray for and love this child.
Thank you. You saw some of the changes on the screen before you came in. The Palm Bosses already had a reception between the services. They will be leaving for Malawi on August 2nd. If there's anything you'd like to say or pray with them or be with them, please do so prior to that. Would you pray with me this morning, please? Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you that people still constantly call in and say, would you lift me up in prayer? I need my people to surround me in prayer. And Lord, we're going to do that this morning. We pray that you would be with Ginger. She was sitting third row back in the first service. Lord, as she prepares for surgery, be with her. We pray the same thing for Carol and for Dale. As they prepare for surgery this coming week, we pray, dear God, that you would bless the doctors, that you would bless the anesthesiologists, that you would guide and direct all the things that they do with their hands, and then you would take them and heal them. For healing, we pray. We pray that you would be with Jackie Van Houten. Lord, we're waiting for results, and we pray, please, that those results would be good, that she would be cancer-free. That's our prayer. We know that Phyllis has not received that word, but dear God, she knows Jesus Christ as her personal Lord and Savior, and she is being a testimony, in spite of this extensive cancer, to everyone she meets that she knows Christ and knows her home. Dear God, we pray that you would be with Trevor, this young child that has gone through brain surgery over and over. We thank you for once again having complete success in this one. We thank you that Kevin is already home. Lord, thank you for that neck surgery. Please heal him completely. We pray that you would be with Nixon James as he's been taken to the hospital. Be with TJ and Stephanie. We pray that those parents would surround him and love him and that he would be healed quickly. Dear God, on the other end of life, we know that there's been families, look at this list, that have laid loved ones in your arms. Be with Ron and Ellis. Be with Lauren and Carol. For Glenn and Jan. For Ben and Hilda. For Bill and Joyce. We were able to go and be with each one of them at the funeral home. And dear God, we can feel your comfort. Dear God, please bless them and be with them as well. We thank you that Steve and April were able to be home with us for an extended period of time. And then this coming week, we pray, Lord, that still they would have more time to contact and be with and pray with and just say goodbye to some as they go back to Malawi. We pray on this trip that you would keep them safe and just be with their ministry. We pray for all of our missionaries. Lord, we should pray a lot more for them. We have supported so many missionaries that have gone out into the world, whether that's be just in our local missions or in other places beyond our borders. Dear God, bless them, we pray. We pray that yesterday morning we were able to meet together with some 100 people, surround them with maybe 100 or 150 more, and pray them as they're heading towards Colorado. These young people are in a place in their life where there's spiritual formation going on. We pray that you would inspire them, that you would come within them, and they would use those gifts and the talents to come and share the gospel of Jesus Christ with many others. Lord, during the first service, we were blessed by a lot of noise outside, but we thank you for rain. There are certain things that human beings can't do, and one of them is to bless this earth with rain, so we thank you. I still know there are farmers in this church in our area. We thank you that you've given us the abundance of rain now, that again, crops are going to be grown not only for our people, but literally the people of the world. Lord, we do pray for our world. We pray in a time where it seems like we turn on the TV time after time after time again, and there is terrorist events happening constantly. Lord, we can't stop them as human beings. We do believe, however, that your Holy Spirit, even though they're not Christian maybe, we pray, dear God, that your Holy Spirit can speak to their heart and soul and say, really, do we really want to do this in the name of a God? dear God, change their mind and change their hearts. And may there be healing in those who've been inflicted with some of these tragedies and these actions. Dear God, we pray that you would turn hatred into love. Lord, we thank you for the baptism we just had. And as we sit here with many of our other children who now look us right in the eye, we can remember the time they were brought before you. May we take our vows as a church and as a family seriously. Heavenly Father, bless the rest of this service, please. We pray, and I've heard this message, as we go into Proverbs, that wise book given to Solomon, guided by your Holy Spirit. Bless Sean to challenge us this morning through your word. And finally, Lord, we thank you for the offering that we can take. We give back to you so because you have given us everything. May we be joyous and generous givers, and may we use it wisely. We pray and ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. In the pew, there are some blue cards. Those are for some visitors. If you're a guest this morning, welcome. If you would be so kind to fill that out, we would love it. Also, we can pass the fellowship pad. Let's worship God with his tithes and our offerings. And kids, we're going to have a children's message this morning. Would you please come up? Thank you. Would you thank the praise team for their leadership this morning? Thank you. Are you ready? One, two, three. Yeah! It is loud, you know. I went around the kids and they said, Jeremy's not here today. I didn't eat my fish until this morning. Now, for those of you who weren't here last week, Jeremy handed out a fish and was taught self-control. They had to watch a piece of candy for a week. Thank you for doing that. Oops, we lost one. That's okay. Kids, I have something in here. You tell me what this is. What are these? We're going to call them sticks. Would you say that? That's right. Oh, I have something else in here. What are these called? Can we call them stones? So we have what? And we have, you know, when I was a little boy, and I don't think that you say this anymore, but there was a saying that said, sticks and stones can break my bones, but words can never hurt me. Kids, you know, sometimes we say some things that aren't true. That saying is not true. Now, words can't break your bones, but words can hurt you. When you open the Bible, it talks about the words we use can either build someone up and make them feel good, or words can hurt them. How many of you have ever been called a name or a naughty word? Does that feel good? No, it doesn't. So we ask you as Christian kids to watch your words, to build other people up, to tell them how nice they are, to help them, not to make them feel bad. Sticks and stones can break your bones, but words can hurt even deeper. Let's pray that God uses our words well. Would you pray with me? Lord, I thank you for these beautiful children. And I pray that you would be in control of their mind, their heart, and their tongues. And that goes for all of us, even the old people like me. Lord, we pray that you would use our words to build others up, not hurt them. Bless these children. And we pray this all in Jesus' name. And all God's children said, Amen. You have been wonderful. You may go back. Thank you.
This summer, we are in the pursuit of wising up. We are in the book of Proverbs, and we are asking God, we're seeking out the wisdom of God, looking at specific aspects and areas of our life where we don't have the wisdom or the strength or the ability on our own. That's why we ask for the wisdom of God in those particular areas. This morning, as you take out a copy of God's Word right there before you, join me, the book of Proverbs, chapter 13, beginning at verse 3. That's page 1002 in a Pew Bible. We're going to start there, but we are going to be turning backward and forward throughout the duration of the message. So please have God's Word open before you and keep it right there. And with Bibles and technology available, again, an opportunity to pray. Father God, for an opportunity to quiet ourselves in your presence, for an opportunity to sing your praises, recognizing that you are the one true God, to be reminded of Jesus and your grace outpoured in our lives. Thank you for baptism. Father, now we ask that you would continue to shape and transform our lives. We pray again for your wisdom in full measure by the power of your Holy Spirit. We do not have the strength on our own. Father, may your word be alive in us all. We pray for it in Jesus' name, and all God's people say, Amen. They were not yet Mr. and Mrs. It was still a bride and a groom, and they stood right here in the absence of the pulpit. They faced one another, and they were joining hands. And as vows and promises were made, there was something to occur next. She had written him a letter. He had written her a letter. Love letters. And holding hands and staring into one another's eyes, I read her words for him. I read his words for her. Words of love, words of encouragement, words of promise, words that brought tears to both of their eyes, words that brought tears to their parents and to their grandparents. Words of love, words of encouragement, words are powerful. Another lady stood behind this pulpit. Intentionally, she paused to catch her breath in an attempt to hold back her tears. As she stepped towards the pulpit, she began to unfold a piece of paper. Her own penmanship creased in the fold and now again wet with her own tears. Once upon a time, she had also made promises to her husband for better, for worse, in sickness and in health, for richer, for poorer, to love and to cherish till death. It was her husband's funeral. And as she stood in this pulpit, she read a letter in recognition of his life, in recognition of his faith in Christ. Words are powerful. And suddenly, the volume at home erupted. And he and she, and husband and wife, were arguing loudly. And the volume continued to raise as they went from level to level and room to room. The volume continued to be on the increase as she wanted to be heard, as he wanted to be heard. The children escaping to a bedroom, putting in their earbuds, closing the door again as the argument, as the verbal fight unfolded. Words are powerful, aren't they? One of them wanted to talk about it. The other one did not. One of them wanted to be understood, wanted an answer, wanted a resolution, wanted to be able to speak it out loud, but the other one did not. And no amount of one-sided questioning, no amount of one-sided begging, no amount of one-sided conversational attempt could draw the other one out of their silent resoluteness. One wanted to talk. The other one did not. Even silent words are powerful. How we speak matters. We profess, we confess that we are followers of Jesus Christ. That makes us different. That sets us apart in this world. We are in this world, but not of this world. We belong to the kingdom of God. So we are Christian women. We are Christian men. We are those who pursue Jesus Christ. That means we talk differently. We communicate differently. How we use words differs from those who are of this world. So this morning we dare to ask God, God, show me when I'm not speaking well. And God, give me your wisdom to choose each of my words wisely. So we begin with God's word. Proverbs chapter 13, verse 3. If you're able to read it, would you please join me as we say together, he who guards his lips guards his life, but he who speaks rashly will come to ruin. Let's do it one more time. He who guards his lips guards his life, but he who speaks rashly will come to ruin. How we speak matters. And how we speak makes a difference. So this morning, pursuing the wisdom of God for the speech of his people. God's going to identify for us speech that does not bring him glory, speech that is not for the building up of people. And God is going to direct us and show us his wisdom and his words. God's going to show us what it means to speak in such a way that it is for the encouragement and it is for the restoration of lives. So number one, I learned a brand new word this week. I want to share it with you. We're talking about number one first, tempestuous words. Would you say that with me? Tempestuous words. Don't ask me how to spell it. What are tempestuous words? What are tempestuous words? They are fiery words. They are fast words. They are furious words, wild and without much consideration or reflection. Tempestuous words are launched without announcement or without warning. It is the mouth that explodes. And normally such tempestuous words are initiated by strong feelings and emotions. Would you turn to Proverbs 12 with me? Proverbs 12, verse 16. Solomon, inspired by the Holy Spirit to paint this picture of tempestuous emotional words. And it says, a fool shows his annoyance, what? At once. A fool shows his annoyance at once, but a prudent man overlooks an insult. Tempestuous words are not considered or thought about in the mind. At once, they explode forth from a person's mouth and they are animated in life. Tempestuous words are emotionally charged verbal bombs. Just a couple of verses later, Proverbs 12, 18, reckless words. Reckless words pierce like a sword, but the tongue of the wise brings healing. Have you ever spoken such tempestuous words? Has your mouth ever erupted at once in response? Has your mouth ever spoken in such a manner and with such language that it pierced the heart, it pierced the life of another person like a sword? Sometimes it might be in person. These tempestuous words passing from your mouth immediately into the eyes and ears and face of another person. Tempestuous words as you are on your tiptoes and you're poking somebody in their chest. Or maybe such tempestuous, emotion-filled words are sent repeatedly in an ongoing text. As you're going back and forth with someone else, you receive their text and you immediately begin sending another one back and another and another and another. Or maybe it's in an email, or maybe it's in a posting on Facebook, but the words are tempestuous, the words are turbulent, the words are furious, the words are designed to hurt and to insult another person. Tempestuous. Sometimes you ask, where would such language come from? Why do I speak that way? Why do I talk that way? Why do I say those things? Why do I write those things? Such fiery language often finds its way from the fiery, unresolved feelings and emotions that burn in your belly. It should be no surprise to us that when your belly burns, the words that come out of your mouth are going to be tempestuously scorching as well. There's so much brokenness there. There's so much hurt there. So much stuff that's not been dealt with, right? Because we're taught, swallow hard. Swallow hard. Just push it down. Tempestuous words are not the design of God. As His people, we should not be involved or engaged in this fiery, emotional dialogue that refuses to think or contemplate, but instead continues to hurl insult and injury at one another. Tempestuous words. Now, tempestuous words are emotionally charged and they arrive in split-second increments. The next category of words is thought out. The next category of words, we're going to call them, number two, twisted words. Would you say that with me? They are twisted words. Twisted words are carefully considered. Say that. They are carefully considered. You roll them around in your mind. Twisted words are intentional. Because they're considered. Because you take the time to think about them. It means that we are designing and we are scheming of a way to hurt another person, to harm her or him. Twisted words bring us to Proverbs 16. Proverbs 16, verse 28. And the wisdom that Solomon is given in that verse sounds like this. Proverbs 16, verse 28. A perverse man stirs up dissension, and a gossip separates close friends. A perverse man stirs up dissension. A perverse man, a perverse woman is stirring up dissension. They are cooking up dissension, cooking up discord, cooking up gossip, cooking up ruin, cooking up an attack against another person. And as they stir, as they think, as they consider, these are twisted words. These twisted words take the truth and manipulate it. These twisted words take the truth and bend it. They only share a portion of the truth while holding another part back. Or they go ahead and they add certain facts to the truth. Or they go ahead and they exaggerate the truth. They're twisting. Twisting. Proverbs 25:18 tells us, just listen to this one, regarding twisted words, like a club or a sword or a sharp arrow is the man who gives false testimony against his neighbor. Like a club, like a sword, like a sharp arrow. This is a person who's been called upon to speak the truth. We're trying to know the truth. We're trying to find the truth. We're trying to come to a decision or to a resolution. And here is the person who stands up and who is intentionally twisting the truth. And God's word says that such a woman or such a man is like a club or a sword or an arrow. With twisted words, they beat against the life of another person. With twisted words, they cut deeply into the life of another person. With twisted words, they pierce immediately through the heart of another person. With words, yes. And God says to me, do you understand the malicious battling nature of those twisted words? They contain no health. They contain no desire for forgiveness, no desire for restoration, no desire for right living. Such twisted words are designed only to bring hurt and death. So in his wisdom, God tells us in his word that these are two particular camps that we might fall into. Those of us who speak tempestuously, emotionally charged, firing off our mouths. And those of us who speak in a twisted manner, only sharing part of the truth, exaggerating part of the truth, dismissing and not acknowledging another part, gossiping, lying. Do you speak like that? I have. I have too often. And the wisdom of God shows us a better way, because God's design is not to tear down and discourage indefinitely, but God's design is to build up. God's design is to encourage, and God's design is to bring about restoration to those he loves. Amen, church? So we want to speak by the wisdom of God. We want to speak with the wisdom of God. So God is going to show us two additional categories of speech. Number three, that third category is this. We need to be those who have thoughtful words. Say that with me, please. Thoughtful words. Because we are those who pursue Jesus Christ. We are followers of Christ, disciples of him. And so we speak thoughtfully. And what is a thoughtful word? A thoughtful word is when the mind and the heart are engaged together and the mouth is closed. A thoughtful word is when the mind and the heart are joined together and the mouth is closed. We want the contemplation of our minds. We want the feelings and the emotions within our hearts to have the opportunity to consider, to look at the whole picture, and to think very clearly, even in prayer, before we open our what? Our mouths. Proverbs 10:19 tells us this. When words are many, sin is not absent. In other words, when there are many words, there is also much sin. When words are many, sin is not absent, but he who holds his tongue is wise. He who holds his tongue is wise. I cannot even begin to tell you how many times growing up, my mom just looked at me and would just simply ask me, "Sean, would you please be quiet?" I appreciate that request more and more as life goes on. You ask now on her behalf, don't you? Would you please be quiet? Thoughtful speech. Thoughtful speech gives the mouth the opportunity to please be quiet, while the head and the heart have an opportunity to look at the fullness of the facts. In Proverbs 11:12, we find that a man who lacks judgment derides his neighbor, but a man of understanding holds his tongue. Be quiet. How often somebody may say something to you, and immediately it resonates with that fire in your belly. And immediately you have a sharp response. And immediately you want to speak it. Immediately you want to text it. Immediately you want to post it for everybody to read. Because it's a good one, right? And you want them to hear it. But thoughtful speech says, no, I'm going to be quiet. I am going to hold my tongue. A trusted friend this week shared with me. Their work brought in a professional from the outside, a professional in terms of communication. And within the dynamics of this company, there's the understanding that we all communicate differently. We have different ways of communicating, different ways of listening and understanding. And the specialist came in and shared with them that both the Bible and the science agree. The Bible and science agree when it comes to how we speak and how we listen. Of course, we shouldn't be surprised by that, right? Because God is our creator of all things. The Bible and science agree when it comes to our words and how we communicate. The specialist shared that the portion of our brain that deals with emotions and feelings is always ready to respond. As soon as we hear something, as soon as we read something, that emotional feeling center of our brain is ready to respond. But did you know? The science shows that we should hold our tongue. Science shows that we should be slow to speak. Because that center of our brain that deals with understanding lags behind our feelings and our emotions by approximately 10 seconds. How many of you grew up with parents who repeatedly sounded something like this? One, two, three, four, five, six, six and a half, six and three quarters, six and 15 sixteenths, six and 15 and a half sixteenths. Science and the Bible agree. Thoughtful words are those words that give our mind and our hearts an opportunity to communicate together and the opportunity for our mouths to be quiet. Choose God's words wisely. Can I tell you that a really good place to work on this is in both marriage and in being a parent? How many times I have not had thoughtful words in marriage, and I have not had thoughtful words in training up my children? Too often I have allowed the fire of my belly to be the fire of my mouth. And too often, it has been tempestuous words. It has not been thoughtful words. That's a work in progress in my life. And I wonder if anyone else here this morning needs to focus on such thoughtful words in marriage, such thoughtful words in training up our children in the way that they should go. Be quiet and give your head and your heart an opportunity to understand. And to those thoughtful words, lastly, fourthly, God shares with us what we will call truthful words. Say that with me. Truthful words. And what are truthful words? They are just that. Words that are filled with truth. There is no room in such truth-filled words for lies. There is no room for exaggeration. There is no room for gossip. There is no room for selfishness or self-centeredness. Truth-filled words are only full of truth. And words of truth are always concerned about the life of another person. Truth-filled words are concerned about the condition of that person's heart, the battle being waged in that person's mind, and the struggles that that person finds himself or herself in. Truth-filled words desire healing in life. Proverbs 12:18, reckless words pierce like a sword, but the tongue of the wise brings healing. Truth-filled words bring healing. They do not promote ongoing brokenness. They do not promote ongoing arguments. They do not promote ongoing discord or animosity. Truth-filled words always desire the best of God to be done in the life of another. And so perhaps the most truth-filled words we'll ever speak are found in 1 Peter 3:15. Would you just listen, because you probably already have this memorized. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. Do this with gentleness and respect. The most truthful words we will ever speak involve the confession of our own faults and failures, involve the confession of our own sins. The most truthful words we will ever speak are shared with the desire of bringing another person to the foot of the cross to see what Jesus accomplished there. The most truthful words we will ever speak invite someone to the reminder of this table that Jesus allowed his physical body, that Jesus allowed his own blood to be poured out for the forgiveness of sins, that we might be healed in a spiritual way, that every brokenness, every pain, every hurt, every struggle would be fully faced by God, and that my life and your life would be redeemed. Are you prepared to give such an answer today for the hope that you have in Jesus Christ? And can you do it with gentleness and respect? Friends, the devil works hard. The devil wants us to speak tempestuously. The devil wants us to speak with fire and emotion and bitterness. But the wisdom of God invites us to quiet our mouths, to consider the fullness of the situation, and instead of engaging in an argument, to see another life that he loves and longs to redeem. What words do you speak? In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Heavenly Father, may the fire in a belly be both quenched and drenched by the outpouring of your Holy Spirit. Father, may any brokenness or sin or animosity that remains within us be addressed at the foot of the cross and in the prayerful presence of Jesus Christ. That our mouths should no longer be on fire, vengefully or with revengeful intentions. But Father, may the words that we speak be filled with truth as we thoughtfully consider the lives of those you love and the lives of those you long to redeem. Father, may our words be yours. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you're able to stand for God's parting blessing, would you please do so? God wants to share his wisdom with us. He does so by the power of his Holy Spirit, that same Spirit who is the author of this book and all the words contained here within. We have the wisdom of God. Will we choose on this day to live it out well? I pray that we do. And in doing so, may we also always know the love of God our Father, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, and the amazing redeeming grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, as all God's people joyfully say, Amen. Word of God, speak.
Bless you.